Hi, and welcome to my talk. I'm Abram Hindle. I'm part of the Department of Computing Science at the University of Alberta. This is for Compute 301, and this will be an introduction to design patterns. So today we'll talk about the motivation behind design patterns. Patterns in general, at least in software, are solutions to a problem in some kind of context. Oftentimes, expertise is the buildup of patterns and pattern recognition and knowing when patterns are appropriate to use, as well as knowing when not to use them. In a sense, an expert gains effectiveness by not deriving all the patterns they rely upon from first principles. This means that they can use their experience, they can use their knowledge to start quickly with good reasoning and experience rather than having to derive a completely new thing. So, the game of chess is very well studied. There are compilations of endgame patterns, there's compilations of opening patterns. So, the general pattern to win this game would be to put one of the kings in check and then checkmate. So patterns that the pieces follow are, or that the pieces that you try to place your pieces in, are ones where you have open diagonals. So in this case, this means that your bishops here have control over an area. And these open diagonals mean that they have control, and you can use that to your advantage because your enemy doesn't necessarily want to move into those spaces if they know they can lose that piece. Other patterns include the isolated pawn. So right here, this pawn is relatively isolated and this pawn is relatively isolated, but they do take up a space. Anything that moves here and here is in danger. Anything that moves here and here is in danger. So this pawn, if it moves up, is in danger of being taken by that pawn. The bishop pair is another pattern that is pretty powerful in chess because it means that you take on entire diagonal rows on both colors. And this is important because some pieces, like bishops, only stay to one color. This means that anyone in this area is in danger of being taken by these bishops. The exposed king is another pattern. It basically says, hey, come in, try to take this, but then you basically have to have your king protected by backups. In this case, the queen backs up that king, the rook backs up there, this bishop takes that space. In this case, you got double rooks. So, chess has patterns, code has patterns. I want you to think about Java code. How often do you see something like this? This is not idiomatic code. This is not code you normally write. This code fills a table from index 9, or fills a table of x from x equals 0 to x equals 8. So you go, you got 9 elements, and you go from 0 to 8. But it has a strange initialization of minus 1 as a pre-increment, and sets the value. Normally, we'd write this as, say, maybe a for loop, or we'd initialize from 0 and increment afterwards. The idiomatic code that you know and that you've seen a lot would be for int I equals 0, I less than 10, I plus plus, table I equals I. So this is idiomatic code. Idiomatic means it's a pattern, it's a common pattern. And in programming, idiomatic programming means programming in the recommended style for that language or that project or the libraries that you're using. So if you write in this style, most people will be able to understand it. This style slows people down and they have to comprehend what you're trying to get across. But both of these things do the same task. So design patterns are basically practical, proven solutions to reoccurring design problems. They're not necessarily as well defined as algorithms or code, but they consist of basically a coherent set of abstractions Like model view controller is probably a pattern you've heard. Maybe you've heard of singleton, but nonetheless, they are named abstractions. Model view controller isn't necessarily as clear as quicksort in terms of an algorithm, but you do know that some objects play a model role, some objects play a view role, and some objects play controller roles. Essentially, the design patterns allow us to build a design vocabulary in more ways than one. So you can imagine we've got this text that describes what we're doing. So I have this data object that notifies all view objects depending on whether it can, whenever the data changes. The nice thing is that the views can be added or removed dynamically, that the data object doesn't need to know the details of each type of view. This has a name. Can you guess it? Well, it's the model view controller pattern or the observer pattern. So, the Gang of Four, four authors, wrote the initial design patterns book, and they created a set of design patterns which are popular to use. And the benefit of them is that there's a shared vocabulary. When I say observer or model view controller, you'll know what I'm talking about. I won't have to say this big block of text. We extend our vocabulary in terms of the design, but we also extend our vocabulary in terms of the spoken names for the designs that we use. By giving a design a name, we give it power. It allows us to communicate very quickly that we're going to use it. Also, we can use things like observer to annotate the names of classes when they exhibit this pattern. So the Gang of Four, they define multiple kinds of patterns. The first kinds were creational patterns. These were about creating objects. So they had the abstract factory, the builder, the factory method, the prototype, the singleton. These are all about creating objects with different constraints, or allowing objects to belong to the same family, or building complicated objects, or allowing inheritance to change how objects are built, or building objects up slowly, or building a single version of an object. Then there's also structural patterns. These include things like adapters, bridges, composites, decorators, facade, flyway, proxies. These patterns, these structural patterns, are about how objects relate to each other and are connected, and thereby how they behave together. Adapters adapt interfaces, facades fake interfaces, proxies act in the place of other objects. Behavioral patterns aim to distribute duties, aim to break up responsibility into multiple smaller classes and objects that can be maybe delegated to, that can initiate commands, that can be interpreted, iterated over, mediated, remembered, observed, or done in a certain way. So there's a whole set of patterns that are related to behavior and how the system operates. So the first pattern we're going to get into is the singleton pattern. The singleton pattern has the design intent of ensuring a class only has one instance, and it provides a global point of access to it. Essentially, you might want to use a singleton because you might only want one instance of that pattern existing in the project at one time. For instance, you might just want one set of references or one set of preference objects for the entire application you have. You might want just one database handle. You might want just one sun or earth. You might want just one world. The singleton pattern is basically like a global encapsulated in some logic. So if it's like a global, how do we implement it? One way is to make a class and then put the singleton in that class as a static variable. So this is read-only static variable, although you can call methods on it. We make an instance of the singleton. We have a private constructor, which means you cannot build this class yourself, but we can make a public static method where you get an instance of that singleton. GetInstance is a very popular name, and you return that instance. So only the singleton can build itself. It builds one copy of itself at the start, and it provides an interface to a static method to produce that singleton. So you would never go new example singleton except here. You would go example singleton dot get instance, and you'd get another singleton example here. Here's where we've got a singleton. We've got a singleton holder. It's got a private singleton in there. We make sure you can't build it. And then when we're done, we return that singleton holder. The nice thing about this is it's harder to get access to it. This is also a private static class. It's a little strange. But what's interesting is there's a hack involved here. And this hack doesn't necessarily work. But the hack is that by having it delegated to this private static class, that this class will not be loaded until you actually call this instance. So it's sort of lazy. This is a bit overcomplicated. There's another method that we can use, which is lazy construction, and I recommend lazy construction over the prior example. In lazy construction, you make a singleton instance, you set it to null, so you don't make it. Then you can make your get instance, and what your get instance does is it checks to see if the instance is null. If the instance is null, it creates a new instance, assigns it to your static private instance, and returns it. If you make your constructor protected, you can enable subclasses while still protecting this private instance up here, as well as you'd still have access to the super get instance. So, what does this do? This doesn't build it till it's needed. This is a good idea for things like database handles, where a database handle, you might not want to make it until you actually need it. Then, once you have it, it's just one quick check to see if you have it, and then it returns. It's very simple. And it doesn't build it until it's needed. Okay, so that was the singleton pattern. In the next videos, I'm going to get into things like the composite pattern, the command pattern, things like that. All right, so we covered the singleton. We provided a lazy construction singleton. We showed a basic singleton where it exists throughout the program. We talked about why we build a singleton. We talked about different kinds of design patterns. We talked about the shared vocabulary we gain from design patterns. And we talked about idiomatic and non-idiomatic code.